Well, thank you very much. It's a pleasure to be here. I really love this conference. I like conferences like this where everybody who's here participates in one way or another. I guess I want to just start by saying to David Rankin, who badmouths whenever he gets a chance, semiotics. This is a semiotic rendition. It's called the three R's, reading, religion, and ritual. So it's sort of meant to shuffle up our notions in the profession of what constitutes literacy. David just wrote a wonderful article in Literacy and Technology Journal. If you haven't read it, he sort of goes through all of the different versions of multimodality theories and sort of really pulls together all of those different kinds of conceptions of how visual literacy sort of operates in text in different ways. And his basic argument is that we ought to be doing things more for practice rather than just theorizing this crap. And I think the article is really important because it really does pull together just a wide variety of theoretical work in sort of the notion of multimodality. I entitled this speech, "What Insights into Written Language Does Art Afford?" or "Some Parallels Between Written and Visual Literacy Learning." I like the question of what does art afford our understanding of literacy, but you can see that I sort of backed away from that so that I'm really sort of talking about literacy learning rather than that broader particular topic today. I also want to just start, this has really nothing to do with my speech, but it's just one of my favorite language examples. Oh, let's see, I'm supposed to do the clicking. Where do I click? Which one? Right. Okay, can you play that?
911, what's your emergency? Yeah, my wife got attacked by a warthog real bad, and I need someone to come up with an ambulance and pick her up. Okay, sir, how can you give me your address? Yeah, we're at 1825 Eucalyptus Drive. Okay, can you spell that for me, sir? I'm going to drag her on over to Oak Street, you can pick her up.
I just love that example. I think that's called having strategies to bail your butt out of situations. Despite the fact that I'm now known as a researcher and an artist, I've always considered myself first and foremost a teacher. And I think I can safely say that about all the colleagues that I've worked with too and co-authored things with. Our interest in literacy generally and early literacy specifically was always an interest in how to set up more supportive classroom environments for language learning in schools. When I see myself as a teacher researcher, I always wanted to be an artist, despite the fact that I ended up being a researcher and a teacher. I, first of all, always wanted to be an artist my whole life. As a child, I sent in a drawing to the Dunwoody Institute in Minneapolis to see if they would accept me based on an advertisement I read on the back of a matchbook cover. I drew the picture, sent it in to them, and lo and behold, I got a letter of acceptance. When I showed my father the letter, he dogmatically declared, "Harste men are not artists." And that was the end of my attempts to become an artist at that particular point in time. While my father squelched my dream, I really defied him by becoming a doodler. And I've doodled my whole life. In actual fact, a lot of people won't sit across from me at a convention because I draw them, and I usually do a horrible job, and they hate the rendition I make of them. But I must say, for all of those of you who are doodlers, I recommend it. It's a great way to get through a faculty meeting. It sort of saved me over all the years at Indiana University. It was really our research on what young children know about reading and writing prior to going to school that rekindled my interest in studying art. Young children as early as 3, 4, 5, and 6 year olds freely moved across various sign systems like art, writing, math, drama, in an effort to mean. One of my favorite pieces of data collected from my daughter, Allison, at age 6, was her multimodal representation of a telephone conversation she had with her friend, Jennifer. After church, Jennifer was going to bring her tutu, slippers, and hair ribbon in a bag over to Allison's house, and Allison was going to get her tutu, slippers, and hair ribbon from the dresser in her room. Together, they were going to, quote, play ballerina. There are three things that really fascinated me about this note. First, the sheer economy of the art itself. It captures not only the subject, but it really sets a tone. The second thing was that Allison's use of language, that is letters, art, and mathematics, the plus sign, to record her message. She very freely moved across sign systems in an attempt to mean. The third thing that fascinated me was the sheer elegance of the note itself. There is no clutter. We can only wish that our telephone conversations ended in such a tidy presentation of what was said. And Allison did this at age 6. Children as early as 3 years old were equally stunning. Here's a picture of an elephant drawn by a 3-year-old. What struck me is how much more we know about the child's conception of an elephant from their drawing than we do from merely saying or attempting to write the word elephant or say it. Because of these experiences, most of my career I have argued for an expanded notion of literacy, one that includes not only written language literacy, but also visual literacy. In an effort to bolster my argument, I asked students to take what they made of reading a text and sketch what they saw as the meaning. It was a strategy I developed called sketch to stretch. Often their pictures captured understandings not present in their reading and in their retelling. Matt, for example, this is from Margie Siegel's dissertation. He's responding to a book about two boys having their first sleepover. Iris sleeps over, and Matt's sister heckles him by asking the main character, "How will you feel sleeping without your teddy bear for the very first time, huh? What do you think your friend's going to say when he finds out your teddy bear name is Fufu, huh?" And she keeps aggravating him this whole way. When Matt was asked to talk about his sketch and specifically the formula he had constructed up in the left-hand corner, he said, "A boy plus a teddy bear plus another boy plus a teddy bear equals two good friends." Now, if you know Iris Leaps Over, this has to be one of the most elegant summarizations of the book that anyone could possibly construct. Like Allison's sketch, the meaning or significance of the event has not only been captured, but the presentation is both uncluttered and elegant. Since there's also been two other dissertations done around sketch to stretch, Phyllis Whiten worked with a group of seventh graders in Columbia, Missouri, and over the course of the year, they started by drawing sketches, but then they also read books and then put them to selected music that they thought represented the books. They also went to art galleries and picked out pieces of art that they thought represented the books. So she really expanded sort of the notion of sketch to stretch. But over the course of the year, these kids had read 37 books. And when you listen to their conversations around the books, it really sounds more like English college professors discussing a text. And before that, the average kid has read less than one book, and most of those was Animal Farm, which they had read several times to get through several other classes. So it was really pretty phenomenal. Then also, I had a student up in Toronto. I teach up in Toronto, even to this day, and I have sort of a moonlighting, I guess. Once you retire, you still got to keep your hands in the profession. So I go up there once a month and then 2 weeks in the summer to work with their critical literacy master's degree program. They sort of built that on a curriculum model that I had developed, and then they asked me to participate. But this gal, Mary McBride, used Sketch to Stretch with special ed kids. And what she found is even though the kids, when they were asked to do retellings of books, you couldn't really figure out if they understood the story or not. But in their Sketch to Stretch, they really were able to capture the underlying significance of the text. So that was a very interesting, I thought about that in terms of assessment, but I think a lot more work needs to be done in that particular area. And I think part of it has to be our education about how to read visual images much more significantly than we have. While I could go on and on about where my interest in art came from, suffice it to say that when I retired from Indiana University, I decided to become a practicing artist. To facilitate this goal, I have studied art for the past 12 years by constantly taking art classes from some of the most talented water media artists that I could find and who I could afford. As a result, I'm now a signature member of the Missouri Watercolor Society, and I'm also a signature member of the Bloomington Watercolor Society, as well as I'm gaining access or a similar status in the Hoosier Salon and the Watercolor Society of Indiana. What a signature status really means in a watercolor society is essentially sort of you're recognized as a master artist by your colleagues. So it's a bit like being promoted to professor at a university. So it's sort of a big deal in the art community. So far, I've introduced you to what I want to say today by first of all making it clear to you that if you scratch me deep enough, despite the fact that I'm talking about art, I am first and foremost a literacy professor interested in broadening our profession's understanding of literacy for the purpose of preparing children for the 21st century. And I want to make that clear. While I no longer see art as being a tool and toy for learning and for thus enhancing language literacy, but a form of literacy in its own right, I remain interested in understanding art literacy and how it might advance our understanding of written language literacy and written and literacy more broadly. To these ends, what I'm going to do today is share three principles that I see operating in both art and written language learning. The first principle is that both art and written language learning demand risking action. I have come to fully endorse Jasper John's advice to artists. Do something to that something, then do something to that something, and soon you'll have something. As a practicing artist, my motto has become ruin at least one sheet of paper every day. Intentionality as a starting point in producing art doesn't really restrict my alternatives. And that's sort of, for those of you who probably don't know my early literacy work, I wrote about 35 pages in Language Stories and Literacy stories about intentionality and how it was sort of the governing force in literacy learning. And essentially this statement is saying I was wrong, probably, in that particular argument. So that's one of the problems about getting old. You find out what goddamn errors you made in your life in terms of saying that. Typically, I paint things about which I feel strongly, both intellectually and emotionally. Most often than not, they have something to do with critical literacy, albeit of a different order than what some might see as literacy. And I'm going to show this definition. I think art at its most powerful speaks back to what is commonly taken for granted in search of truth. I think the fact that art does this aesthetically invites reflection rather than offense, and when successful, the impulse to change how one is being seen or positioned in the world. I think that's probably a controversial statement, and I think probably if I were to unpack it, I could probably write a whole paper around that, and I probably might even lose the argument to myself when I'm done. But that's currently, I guess, how I see what it means to use art in a powerful kind of way. Now, I'm not saying that every piece I've ever done meets these standards. I'm just saying the pieces that I really like, I think, come closer to this particular standard in doing it. And I guess if we have time at the end, we can sort of unpack that a little bit more. This is a photo of the Fountain of the Muses at Brook Green Gardens in Merrill's Inlet, South Carolina. I absolutely love this sculpture and the feeling I get from the sheer aesthetics of the piece. The muses are light, joyful, running, receiving their gifts from the gods. Here we have the poet, the sculptor, the artist, and we have one muse who is, like us, waiting to see what gift God might bestow on him. I also love watching the people come to view the sculpture and ponder its meaning. While the garden's reflecting pool and water spraying from the nostrils of dolphins in which the muses are riding are positioned beautifully, these factors themselves can't fully explain why so many visitors, like my sea elf, report that their initial sighting almost takes their breath away. And that fountain is what stimulated the cover to the journal that you have in that particular painting. This is called The Muses Among Us. This is a piece of art that I created in response then to that fountain. What I wanted to capture, what the experience meant to me, and aesthetics played a central role. You can see I tried to capture the running water by overlaying the piece with tissue paper dyed pink and by adding some string vertically up and down the paper. I wanted to capture the uplifting qualities that the sculpture seemed to exude. The arts were gifts from the gods, making mere mortals something more. There are really three levels here: the muses, the people viewing the muses, and then the shadows of all of us looking in on the unfolding. I've entitled this piece, The Muses Among Us. I started this piece by taking a sheet of 30 by 30 inch piece of my best watercolor paper, and then I froze. There was just too much I wanted to say and no obvious place to begin. The emotional feel that I wanted to convey seemed critical if I were to create a painting I would deem successful. I decided to begin by laying down strings and using tissue paper I had dyed pink to overlay the whole entire paper. Since I was going to cover the whole paper and didn't really know what I was doing when I set the mood, but to set the mood I wanted, I decided, well, hell, I might not as well ruin a good sheet of paper. Take a sheet of paper that I had already started the painting on and that's what I decided to do. In that painting, I tell you, this has been sort of an ongoing project since I retired. I really wanted to do a conversational series, and I wanted to sort of capture the intimacy of conversation. And I was interested also in males' conversation, because I think females talk to one another and share intimacy, but males don't. So at any rate, this isn't the painting I covered up. This is one that I just did recently that I think is actually halfway successful. The one that I covered up was another attempt at conversation, and God damn it, the thing didn't work. So I had this big sheet of paper with this crappy set of people who didn't really look like they were having a conversation. So that's what I decided to use. And lo and behold, what happened is when I did the covering up, the faces of the conversationalists on the first sheet shone through. And that's where I sort of got that epiphany of, oh, we got people looking in on the muses. So it was sort of that abductive leap that led me to layering out essentially three sort of layers. We had the muses being giving their gifts, we had the people viewing the muses, and then the people looking in. So it was sort of a three-tiered kind of paper, and I really loved that particular effect of it in that. So now I want to go back to what I said as the first principle. Do something, then do something, then do something, then do something, then do something, and then you'll have something. So essentially, that's what I did. My first do something was to get rid of the clean sheet of art paper and substitute it for one that was already messed up. I had little to lose. My second do something related to setting the stage. I wanted the feeling of the water flowing, verticality, and softness. To that end, I laid down string, spritzed tissue paper pink, and glued it on top of the original painting. My third do something was to add muses, people observing the muses, and when necessary, pull out the underlying faces I wanted to keep from the original painting. The net result was that I thought I had something. This was particularly confirmed for me when JoLLE agreed to publish the paper when I sent it in. I really love JoLLE for being so generous in terms of publishing my work. I love it. And the other thing that really sort of confirmed that I was on a good track is I put it into a watercolor show in Myrtle Beach, and within the first five minutes of it hanging, it sold. And I also sold it for $500, which really surprised me, because when I put the $500 on, I thought, well, here's another one going to the garage. My wife maintains she has the largest collection of Jerry Harste paintings in the world in her garage. So, and I think she's right. This is called American Heritage, and it has a similar history. My art teacher at the time, Linda Myers Wright, asked us to cut three shapes out of contact paper, something that you normally use to line kitchen shelves, you know, that kind of sticky stuff. Oh. I see, I stuck that in. Yeah, there we are. So I cut sort of three heart-shaped shell stickers. I stuck the dang things on the paper, and then what she asked us to do is to spritz the paper with the contact paper on. And then once that dried, she asked us to take the little stickers off. So what you ended up with the spritz thing with, and then she said, now make something of it. And I went, oh God. So I looked at it and I went, God, they really look like butts. So I decided to make sort of this human beginning to stand erect. And so I painted in the human sort of standing erect, and then I put the paper aside. I couldn't think about what I wanted. I didn't really like what it was. And then I was reading a book on the Sioux Indians. I think it was I think it was the Cherokee Indian, History of the Cherokee. I can't remember the name of the book, but I got this inspiration of an Indian, and I thought, oh, You know, we think about Indians sort of as Native Americans and as savages and not really a civilized man. And so I thought, so I took the image of an Indian and juxtaposed it on the paper. And then I threw on sort of the jungle thing to sort of accent the savagery that we normally, that is typically associated with Native Americans, to force people to rethink that whole concept of civilized man and its importance in society. So that really, it appealed to me because of its ability to sort of juxtapose a different message on top of it. I liked the final product, and I was particularly pleased when it was juried into the Missouri International Watercolor Show. More to the point, however, readers will again note that the do something, do something, do something pattern underlies this particular painting too. Principle two, risk involves trouble. Luckily, trouble invites abduction. John Dealey argues that there's really three kinds of logic. He defines inductive logic as involving collecting data and coming to a conclusion. So what you're essentially doing is you're making observations and then you're making a conclusion on the basis of those observations. Deductive logic is sort of the opposite of that. Deductive logic is you start with a theory, you generate what you think are logical hypotheses, and then you test out those hypotheses and find out whether the data adds credence to those hypotheses or don't. And that's the way science progresses. Abductive logic, according to Dealey and according to Peirce, follows no direct traceable path. Dealey quotes Charles Sanders Peirce as liking it to intuition, a sensation that results in sort of a leap to new understanding. It's supposedly what women are supposed to have a lot of. That is, not necessarily coming to a conclusion from a logical deduction, but rather sensing something that's sort of ephemeral and jumping to a conclusion that really leads to new particular grounds. Now, abductive logic, Dealey argues, takes us to new ground. The third painting that I want to share with you today is really another failed Muse painting. As you can see, my thinking was that what worked once might work again. To that end, I took out a 12 by 18 piece of 140-pound watercolor paper and covered it with tissue paper and, of course, my strings. In this painting, I wanted to capture the need to break down walls as historically both writing and art were seen as gift from the gods. By that position, very few of us were lucky enough to be so blessed. I began by adding muses, but this time I wanted to create the illusion of them creating new territory by breaking down old walls. To that end, I used charcoal to sketch in the muses and white gesso to create a crumbling stone wall. I was taking a course on composition with Rebecca Zeidel at the time, so I was trying to use one of the art designs that she had shown us as being sort of central to the way to organize art, to have a unified composition. Well, no matter what I did, it seemed to me that the muses were very separated and there was no sort of path for your eye to follow through the painting. And finally, I got just sick and tired of it. I put my paintbrush in black gesso, I put it in water, and I just took watery gesso and put the design right over the top of what I had. It was a very brave sort of gutsy act. But I really liked the results. Now, while most people will hardly be able to see the muses in this particular painting, what was really interested is that they're there if you look closely. Some wag once said that good art should not only capture your attention, but it should force you to walk in and take a closer look. So if you take that closer look, you might then see the muses that are underlying that. What was interesting also about this painting is I put it into the Missouri Watercolor Society, and it won the, and it, I got a prize for it being of merit value. And then when I got it back home, I sent it to the Hoosier Salon for their competition for the year, and it won the best non-objective abstract category. So a very interesting sort of results. I also since then have sold it, and I've sort of kicked myself because, I don't know, sometimes your babies, it's just so hard to sell them and never see them again. My third principle is abduction invites optimism, chutzpah, and trust in yourself in the learning process. The fourth painting I want to share with you is a painting I call Hoosier Basketball. For those of you who know Jacob Lawrence's work, you will no doubt see the influence. Powerful figures, flat, pure colors, all in service of the emotional experience being recreated, which takes central stage. Through art, Jacob Lawrence, himself an African American, captured the black experience of growing up in America. I did several workshops for teachers using Jacob Lawrence's work as a model from which one might grow as an artist and literacy learner. After identifying a social issue about which they felt strongly, I invited teachers to use Jacob Lawrence's sense of art to capture their emotional response to an issue that they thought was important. In Bloomington, Indiana, I think as in Athens, Georgia, basketball is a big deal. In this painting, I tried to capture the dominance of the Hoosiers as they played against the University of Michigan, one of many teams we have and will continue to face. I also wanted to position Indiana as being extremely aggressive, not playing particularly fair, standing in front of the damn basket, and doing all the things that Indiana basketball is known to do, except throwing a chair and, of course, hitting people on the stage. I mean, Bobby Knight, we have the history of Bobby Knight, and I think we're still paying $13 million to coaches we fired, one of which was now here, Cream, right? And you all love him. Now, some of you might call this forgery, as it mirrors Jacob Lawrence's thinking about art as well as his style. Yet, I see it as an instance of not only what all artists and writers do, but what it is they should do. It's by getting into the head of an artist, by really understanding what the artist has done and was trying to do, that you grow. What worked for Jacob Lawrence can work for you, not necessarily as a direct copy of his work, but as an opportunity to try out his style and thinking in a new work. If Jacob Lawrence were a Hoosier, this work may well be attributed to him. But this is not really my problem. If somebody takes this piece, signs it with Jacob Lawrence's name, maintaining that it was created by Jacob Lawrence, he, rather than me, is the one involved in forgery. Well, Hoosier Basketball, as well as my painting Out of the Box Scholarship, has been clearly influenced by my study of Jacob Lawrence. They are nonetheless Harste originals. Every painting I've ever painted shows the influence of someone I have studied with or studied closely with. As an artist, one really doesn't have to worry about forgery in its pure sense. Even if I wanted to, it's more difficult than you think to replicate even what initially might appear to be a forgeable work. Even with conscious efforts, my painting inevitably turned out unique. These are three renditions, essentially, of the same painting that I've done, in which I really meant to forge myself, but by the time I get done, they're very different paintings. I can't even forge myself. I've tried. The piece that JoLLE published called A Steadying Force was really an attempt to replicate a piece I had done earlier of my mother as I remembered her. Hannah's Latin life is yet a third attempt. In each instance, I began by wanting to replicate my first painting, but somehow each came out very differently, due in part, I think, because I was a different painter at the time, and because of the little decisions I made. In studying the students in Toronto, one of the things that, and in the paper that follows David's paper in the Literacy and Technology Journal, we talk about the hop-on, hop-off experience we did in Toronto with students. And one of the things that Peggy Elber says in that paper is that, you know, every little choice that the students made allowed for new abductive leaps, which then allowed students to explore new meanings in their work. I think that notion of making different decisions, which then lead to different sort of abductive leaps, is an important component of all the different arts. Here, there's a photographer. I was reading the book Trail of Broken Wings by Sonia Badani. And in it, here's what she says about photography. When I take a picture, it's a multiple-step process. First, I view the scene with my naked eye. Once I finalize the details, make sure the focus is clear, I look through the lens and start snapping. Something hidden finds its way into the picture. A person passing by, or an animal in flight, a child playing, or a look between friends. Something I missed, because I was so focused on the vision in my head, reveals itself in the picture. With the unexpected addition, I am mesmerized. The picture has a new life, one I never have foreseen. It changes the story. What I had hoped to say becomes altogether different. The new story is superior, told in a way I couldn't fathom. Those are the moments when I especially love what I do, when the picture becomes the storyteller and I am the recipient of the story it tells. I think what abduction, the importance of abduction is that it allows you to jump to see something that you would never have imagined possible in the beginning. I also think that's what makes the writing process so exciting, but I think it's also what makes art so exciting. And if I were to argue, I would argue that art affords abduction easier than writing does. That it sets up the condition. It seems to me that every time you're painting, you get yourself in trouble. Now, I think you do the same thing in writing and in different uses of media. I think there comes a time when you produce essentially a teenager with acne, and that you have this clunker on your hands, and it's at those moments that really the best things happen. It's at those moments that you got to come to a new conclusion. Now I'm going to go into my conclusion of this speech, and I want to come back to the notion of reading and writing relationships in that. I think hell for a writer is sitting in front of a computer screen with the blinker constantly blinking, just waiting for you to have a really great idea. I can't tell you how often I've done that, hoping God would come to me with some inspiration that would give me this great beginning for a piece. And I'm just sure that if I go to hell, that's what it's going to be like. I'm going to have a computer screen in front of me just waiting for me to again save the world, I guess, or something. But I think hell for an artist is a blank sheet of paper. And it may even be worse, because the paper usually costs a lot of money because your friends talked you into buying some bloody kind of paint. I don't know. There's always this hope as an artist that if I bought just the right damn paintbrush or just the right piece of paper, my next piece of art would just be wonderful. I don't know why we continue to do that, but we do. Said differently, I think Principal Wen can be seen as the command. In order to become literate in both art and writing, the learner has to take action. I'm not sure I'm justified in saying that in order to become a better writer, pick up a paintbrush and begin to paint. In order to become a better artist, pick up a pen and begin to write. Nevertheless, what I do know for sure is that in order to become an artist, you need to pick up a paintbrush and paint. In order to become a better writer, you need to pick up a pen and write. What you learn using one system of meaning supports what you need to learn in another system of meaning. Regardless of the mode, first drafts are more important than final drafts. First drafts, I think, keep the door open to real learning. In working with doctoral students over my time at Indiana University, I was found it was very difficult to support students in thinking through their dissertations by simply having a conversation with them. My best advice seemed to go in one ear and out the other. Many times the students I found was no further along in thinking through their dissertation on their second visit to my office than they were on my first visit. As a result, I instituted a policy that students needed to come to me with a rough draft of what they think their dissertation was about, why that was important, what data they were planning to collect, and at least some initial thinking about how they planned to do their analysis. What I found is that once we had a draft to work with, no matter how rough it was, I could help them. I could help them clarify their research question as well as share with them who I thought they needed to read in addition to those they've already cited. I wrote many an article with Carolyn Burke. Carolyn is really a brilliant thinker, but she's a very reluctant writer. She would often take a whole day to write a damn sentence. Now, once she wrote the sentence, you could take it to the publisher because there was nothing wrong with it, but she would drive you absolutely goony if you waited around for her to produce a particular article. We would often sit down and we would talk about articles we were invited to write, and we would do complete outlines. And then I would go and I'd write a first draft. And you know, the outline, I had to start with an example that really made sense to me. No matter what Carolyn advised or how she thought it should be structured, I had to start with something that really resonated with me. And I often would. I'd take it back to Carolyn, and then we'd work on it together to make sure that the points that we wanted to make were still highlighted and not hidden. But we needed that first draft. Just talking about it did not solve the thing I did. I also have done a lot of work with doctoral students, and I've done a lot with co-authoring articles, and I'm working with teachers because I wanted teachers to have their own voice. One of the things that Mary Cochran Smith, Susan Lytle really taught me is that one of the problems with teachers writing is that they haven't done enough reading of the kind of work that you want to, and in order to really solve that, you have got to create a study groups where you can read articles, talk about articles, you can get a sense of what goes into a professional article. Otherwise, and I think what's important about that goes back to the collaborative nature of learning. I think we learn a lot from the presence we're in. It's not, and I think it's very important that most of my art has been with other teachers and with working with other teachers and reading other teachers. I think art is a social learning event, the same as language is a social event. And I think it's very important that we acknowledge that. I also want to say something about sketch to stretch. One of the things that Carolyn Burke taught me in working with doctoral students is that oftentimes the last chapter of the dissertation is a dull thing. That is, it sort of summarizes the dissertation and that's it. And Carolyn would insist that the student do a sketch to stretch. That is, she would ask them to say, I want you to draw a model of what you have just concluded. How does that relate to existing models? I want you to draw it conceptually. Now that drove students nuts, but I had 24 students that won dissertation awards, and I'm convinced that that simple act is what got them either the dissertation award or the publication. Their ability to conceptualize it in a different way really elevated their work to a new status, a new ground. Now, I think there it would be interesting to really carry that off into research, but I think this ability to go into another sign system is a very generative cognitive process, but I think it's also an extremely important intellectual move of how we think about things. In some ways, this is an argument in support of the reading and writing connection. In a broader sense, it's an argument that learning is a social event, whether we're talking about art or writing. Simultaneously, it's an argument that experience of paying close attention to what others are doing and how it is represented is an important component of learning. Bakhtin says all texts reside in texts. This is true as someone's writing as well as their art, even though both the artist and the author can claim the work is original. Some wag once said, optimism is going after Moby Dick, chutzpah is taking the tartar sauce with you. In a similar vein, I want to argue that learning new techniques precipitates optimism as well as agency. One artist I studied with suggested that we identify a common object, and every time we sit down to paint, we warm up by painting that object. At the time this advice was given to me, I had just returned from visiting the Modern Museum of Art in New York City, and I had seen Picasso's goat for the first time. I fell in love with that goat, and I did a sketch of it in my sketchbook. So when the professor said, pick an object, and the first thing that popped into my mind was Picasso's damn goat, you can guess the result. I have literally lots and lots and lots of goat paintings in which I try to out different techniques. What a wide range of techniques offers is both a way of self-correction and inevitably, in both writing and art, one text reaches that awkward stage and you need some way to bail yourself out. Harste has gone nuts was a comment I heard from another student when I was attending a course. We had been asked to create stamps out of a rubber pad, and we were supposed to create original stamps because if you use store-bought stamps, you can't enter it into an international show. So you've got to have your own stamp. And so I created a stamp, and then we shared our stamps with different. And so I tried everybody's stamp, and I just stamped the hell out of this piece of paper. And that was what elicited, oh no, Harste's gone nuts. Well, I didn't know really what to do with that stupid stamping. But as I looked at it, I thought, oh, it looks like graffiti. And so then it reminded me this is the painting that result of a graffiti artist, but it reminded me of this. I had been collecting graffiti in Toronto, and one of my favorite pieces of graffiti was this one that I found on a wall in Toronto, billboards for the rich, spray cans for the poor. And so I loved going back thinking about graffiti as we see it as defacement, but rather than as common man's way of getting his voice heard in the world. So that is what sort of appealed to me. It captures, I think, that voice of the commoner, a voice that is one of that 1% who's often not heard. What is equally important about this piece is that it captures not the notion that through doing something, one not only develops voice, but also one outgrows one's very self in the process. believe in the power of abduction. It is the only way that something new gets into the system, be that system written language, visual literacy, or curriculum. Do something. The big lesson here is that you can trust the learning process. It works across science systems and is the fodder upon which you and our profession might grow more inclusively. Thank you very much. Do we have time for questions? Or have I outlived my status?
5 minutes for questions.
5 minutes, any questions? Yeah. Diane.
One of the things that I was thinking about as you were talking is, what do you think about the possibility of having collaborative art? Like, because I personally love collaborative writing.
Yeah.
And collaborative art seems never to be talked about or doesn't happen.
Yeah, we were talking about what we were going to do this summer up in Toronto. And one of the things I wanted to do was sort of, I guess it was community collaborative art. I wanted students to have an invitation to community members to produce a sculpture collaboratively about some environmental issue. Hillary Jenks did a thing on water. And what they did is the community members all collected water bottles, and 1,500 water bottles are used in the United States every hour. Is that right? And what they did is they collected 150 plastic water bottles, and then they formed it into an oil sculpture in the park. But it kept that conversation going. So I'm very much interested. I did one piece of art. My granddaughter was doing art. When I was doing art, she got interested in art, and she was 5 years old. And so she did this painting, and you know how kindergarten kids use color? And it was just so vibrant. And I saw this wolf in it, and I just sort of did a couple marks with her and pulled out the wolf. And in one of the art shows, I showed that piece and told how it was developed. And Carolyn Burke says, "Oh, you should use that as a strategy in schools." And but you know, I don't. You know that it's hard for me to think how you'd set that up in some sort of meaningful way. But I too am very much interested in the whole notion of collaborative art. I just don't. I can see it as a social statement that might be made, but I don't know how to sort of work on a sort of individual basis with it, you know, because I've tried, Peter, I'm sure you've done that too, where you take somebody's writing and have it passed to somebody else and they add things to it. Usually that turns out to be pretty crappy, but I don't know, or that's been my experience. I haven't been very happy with that. Did you want to say something about that? Yeah.
Expressing an intended meaning and figuring out a way to do that. And then we learned that actually working with a fellow author or a group of authors is actually better. And you're right, the writing not only comes to intend something new, but it also expresses that new intention better by having it than more than one person.
Yeah, you know, probably I was wrong in saying that it was crappy writing. Probably I didn't have the right eyes. Probably what we need to do is do that even with the writing, passing it around, and then looking where we get abductive leaps. Probably it's not as bad as, probably what I was reading is sort of missing the big picture in that. So that's an interesting sort of thought. You know, I was trying to figure out, I know I've not had any formal training in art, but I was trying to figure out the art world, And I think one of the things that's really significant, and it's in my definition of what I see as powerful art, is I think that major changes in art are speaking back to previous eras. And I think one of the things that's really wrong with museums is that they put all kinds of work from different periods right next to each other. So it's very confusing to see what some artists, you know, when they say Picasso made this big revolutionary change, it's hard to know what that really means because we don't know what he was speaking against. And I think this notion of speaking against normativity, which I think is part of what makes art really powerful, is it gets people to reflect on what's taken for granted. It's much like, isn't it Shirley Bryce Heath has said that good research should surprise you, that it's, you gotta say what's common in a surprising way. I can't remember how that statement goes, but she said, it isn't that you're really breaking new grounds. What you're doing is you're identifying what's taken for granted in a surprisingly new way. And I think that same sort of concept holds in the art community. Okay. Well, thank you all very much. This has been a wonderful conference, and I thank you for having me.